السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونستهديه، نؤمن به ونتوكل عليه، نعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. ثم أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كلام الله، وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، فإن كل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار، وإنما توعدون لآت وما أنتم بمعجزين. My dear respected brothers and sisters in Islam, I spoke yesterday the first session concerning da'wah, and as I said, this da'wah, it is enough honor for any Muslim to carry the work of da'wah, that he is putting himself in the shoes of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is enough honor for you to be concerned about doing da'wah, because when you give da'wah, you are doing the job which is the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam been sent for. And by making da'wah, you are fulfilling the purpose which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had created you for. As he stated, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ, that Allah had created you as well as the jinn only to worship him, to know him, to acknowledge him, to attribute all kind of form of worship to him alone. And for you to invite others to the way of Allah, to know Allah, to acknowledge Allah, to know his way, what's pleasing him, this is a form of ibadah. Like salah is a form of ibadah, siyam is a form of ibadah, the da'wah is a form of ibadah. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had commanded us in Quran the same way he commanded us to make salah, wa aqimu as-salata wa atu az-zakah, he commanded us to pray and to give zakah, he commanded us also to give da'wah, as well as he commanded his Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam by saying, ud'u ila sabili rabbika bil hikmah wal maw'idhatil hasanah, invite them to the way of your Lord with hikmah, with wisdom and good admonishment. And also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as he commands the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he commands us by saying, وَلْتَكُمْ مِنْكُمْ أُمَّةِ, that let it be a group among you, يَدْعُونَ إِلَى الْخَيْرِ, invite others to the good. So inviting others to the good is the work of the prophets all before, as well as the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The work of da'wah is obligatory. And yesterday I had mentioned approximately about 10 reasons why that we have to give da'wah. Among these reasons, only as a quick recap, I said that is because this is honor for us, that we carry the job of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that we try to imitate him by giving da'wah, that we worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through giving da'wah, That number three, we try to get a great reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it's sufficient for us to understand that if you give anybody da'wah, he became a Muslim through you, through your effort, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give you reward as equal to the reward of his good deed without diminishing anything from his reward. It's so great reward for giving da'wah. Also, it is perfection and completion for our iman. As the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam informed us, that لا يؤمن أحدكم حتى يحب لأخيه ما يحب لنفسه. None of you will be a believer until he loves for his brother what he loves for himself. And also the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam telling us that when you see a munkar, you change it with your hand, with your tongue, if you could not with your heart. And after this he said, is nothing beyond this from iman. So we give the da'wah because changing the munkar by giving da'wah is part of faith, to complete your faith and to perfect your faith. Also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us, indeed you have the best example in the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and one of his main things that he was doing, that giving da'wah. So by giving da'wah, we follow the path and the sunnah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We said the necessity of giving da'wah for the continuation of Islam. Because if we did not give da'wah, how is this world and how is this Islam will go to others? And one of the main things the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam informed us, that each prophet used to be commissioned and sent to his own ummah, to his own community only, for his own locality. But the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam been commissioned for all mankind, for the black and the white, for the Arab and the non-Arab, for the red and the yellow. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, his da'wah is for all mankind. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had died already, had passed away, and it is our job to carry this da'wah after his death to continue to be flourish. We said we give da'wah to provide healthy atmosphere of practicing Islam. And we give the example of the group that they went in a trip and they went by renting a boat, and I'm not going to repeat it again, so next time you don't miss any sessions. How many of you taking a nap now? Also, we said that we have to give da'wah to solve our economic problem. As we see in the Quran that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala informed us that if the people of the town had believed, لنزلنا عليهم بركات من السماوات والأرض. It's only if they believe, if they accept the da'wah, that Allah will send barakat and blessings on them from the heaven. So when we have a serious problems with our economic, is people homeless, people do not have work, is because they run away from the way of Allah. So we need to give da'wah to improve our economic condition. As inshallah we're going to see it also today in our session for today. Also we said we give da'wah so we can have the happiness of this life and the reward of the hereafter. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala stated in surah, who knows and take a dollar. You see, you miss it again. In surah Al-Asr, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said, وَالْعَصْرِ إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَفِي خُسْرِ إِلَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالْحَقِّ وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالصَّبْرِ. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had informed us that all mankind are in a state of what? Except those? And or? Which one? And. So the problem with some Muslims, they understand it what? Except those who believe, or عمل الصالحات, or give da'wah, or they have sabr. Doesn't work like this. It's four qualifications for success. To be out of the state of loss, which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say, all mankind are in it. One, plus two, plus number three, number four. What is number three? Giving da'wah. وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالْحَقِّ, which is the truth. فَمَاذَا بَعْدَ الْحَقِّ إِلَّا الضَّلَالِ. Also we give da'wah. I didn't start it. This is a hint that mean enough what you're talking about. Let's answer the question. All right. No problem. MashaAllah. Jazakumullah khairan. And let me tell you one thing before I finish my lecture. I would like at least to recite this surah for you today, which dealings with da'wah programs that we're talking about today. Thank you, sisters. I understood the hint that you sent questions that mean enough talking. This surah called Surah Nuh. I think you say it in English, Noah. This surah, surah number 71. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إنا أرسلنا نوحا إلى قومه أن أنذر قومك من قبل أن يأتيهم عذاب أليم. قال يا قوم إني لكم نذير مبين أن اعبدوا الله واتقوه وأطيعون يغفر لكم من ذنوبكم ويؤخركم إلى أجل مسمى إن أجل الله إذا جاء لا يؤخر لو كنتم تعلمون قال رب إني دعوت قومي ليلا ونهارا فلم يزدهم دعائي إلا فرارا وإني كلما دعوتهم لتغفر لهم جعلوا أصابعهم في آذانهم واستغشوا ثيابهم وأسروا واستكبروا استكبارا ثم إني دعوتهم جهارا ثم إني أعلنت لهم وأسررت لهم إسرارا فقلت استغفروا ربكم إنه كان غفارا يرسل السماء عليكم مدرارا ويمددكم بأموال وبنين ويجعل لكم جنات ويجعل لكم أنهارا ما لكم لا ترجون لله وقارا وقد خلقكم أطوارا ألم تروا كيف خلق الله سبع سماوات طباقا وجعل القمر فيهن نورا وجعل الشمس سراجا والله أنبتكم من الأرض نباتا ثم يعيدكم فيها ويخرجكم إخراجا والله جعل لكم الأرض بساطا لتسلكوا منها سبلا فجاجا قال نوح رب إنهم عصوني واتبعوا من لم يزده ماله وولده إلا خسارا ومكروا مكرا كبارا وقالوا لا تذرن آلهتكم ولا تذرن ودا ولا سواعا ولا يغوث ويعوق ونصرا وقد أضلوا كثيرا ولا تزد الظالمين إلا ضلالا مما خطيئاتهم أغرقوا فأدخلوا نارا فلم يجدوا لهم من دون الله أنصارا وقال نوح رب لا تذر على الأرض من الكافرين ديارا إنك إن تذرهم يضلوا عبادك ولا يلدوا إلا فاجرا كفارا رب اغفر لي ولوالدي ولمن دخل بيتي مؤمنا وللمؤمنين والمؤمنات ولا تزد الظالمين إلا تبارا If we reflect in this surah, this will be sufficient for us in our program about da'wah. First of all, which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us that He send Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the Allah, as he said in Quran, Allah yastafi min al-malaikati rusulan wa min al-nas. This up to Allah. Allah choose. Inna arsalna nuhan. Verily we commission Nuh for this purpose of risala. To go to his people, not to somebody else.
And this is what we just talk about, that each prophet came before to his own people. Not as they said that Jesus came and he told them, go all over and preach the Bible. This is a big lie, okay? Each prophet came to his own nation. And one of the main things that the Prophet ﷺ been given as a specialty for him, different from all the prophets, that he been commissioned to all mankind. إلى قومي أن أنذر قومك. What is his job? To be a nazir, to be a warner. من قبل أن يأتيهم عذاب أليم. Because if you did not answer the call of the messenger, if you did not accept the da'wah of Allah, is not going to be accept عذاب أليم. A punishment, painful torment. قال يا قوم. Now listen. قال يا قوم إني لكم نذير مبين. He said, oh my people. And this shows you what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, ادعو إلى سبيل ربك بالحكمة والموعظة الحسنة. May Allah give you a good wife, brother. In paradise. I mean in paradise. In case, you see, always you have to be cautious, because if he's married, he say, I meant from in paradise. But if he's not married, he will get one. He said, ya qawm, oh my people. And this is the way it shows you that you need to humble yourself as a da'iyah. You need to get to their hearts, okay? You need to see how you can win their feeling, their consideration, their attention, and always try to use their, this what you call emotion, or get into their feeling, like families, oh my son, okay? Oh my dad, oh my father. So this is what he used, the Prophet Nuh. He said, oh my people. So he reminds them about the relationship and the ties between him and them. I'm one of you, okay? I'm concerned, oh my family, oh my father. And say, like the Prophet Ibrahim, قَالَ يَا أَبَتِي, oh my father. So he tried to establish this kind of relationship, that I'm coming out of what? Out of concern. So when you approach the person, you have to show him that you are not coming. You don't care about this business he got. You don't need his money. You don't need anything. I'm only concerned about you. Okay? I'm giving this da'wah because I care for you. Because the Prophet ﷺ said that any Yahudi or a Nasrani who hears about the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ, he doesn't believe in him, he will be in hellfire. You see? So out of this rahmah, and this mercy, that we going out because we want to snatch the people out of this punishment and this hellfire. قَالَ يَا قَوْمِ إِنِّي لَكُمْ نَذِيرٌ مُبِينٌ. I'm a clear warner to you. What? Number one in the establishment of da'wah, don't start talk about politics, don't start talk about head, khimar, don't start talk about beard. Look, the first thing he starts with it is what? Tawheed. The first thing he starts with what? Is aqeedah. The first thing is to lay down your foundation, because this is the main thing. Who do you worship? Who is Allah? Who is that you devote yourself to? قُلْ يَا أَيُّهَا الْكَافِرُونَ لَا أَعْبُدُوا مَا تَعْبُدُونَ وَلَا أَنْتُمْ عَابِدُونَ مَا أَعْبُدُ وَلَا أَنَا عَابِدٌ مَا عَبَدْتُمْ وَلَا أَنْتُمْ عَابِدُونَ مَا أَعْبُدُ لَكُمْ دِينُكُمْ وَلِيَ دِينِ. This is the main thing. Who do you worship? Who is your God? Who is Allah? All of us, about you see, we don't let these things understand make differences between us. Because all of us worship God, okay? You call him Jehovah, I call him Allah, he call him Jesus, he call him... No, hold it. Slow down. No, we are not worshiping the same God. We are not worshiping the same God, neither we have the same methodology of formality of worshiping this God. So we are different from you in two things. What? The one that we worship and the way how we worship. Alright? Yeah. It's not all of us, you call him Jehovah, you call him Allah, you call him, you see, but all of us. Huh? Let's try to go for a ride, let's go for a walk, you understand, demonstration for peace. Let's go for demonstration for Bosnia. Let's understand, not go sit down and debate about, no, this number one. This number one, I'm not going to talk about, you understand, about human rights and women rights and go for a ride with you and go for demonstration in front of the yellow house or the red house. No, I'm not concerned about this. I'm concerned about who is the Lord, who is God, what is the quality. Okay, you're going to call him this and I call him that. forget about the name for a minute. Tell me about some of his quality. قل هو الله أحد. الله الصمد، لم يلد ولم يولد ولم يكن له كفوا أحد. الله لا إله إلا هو الحي القيوم. Do you worship what I worship? He is high and he is قيوم. But your Lord, according what you're saying, he was dead for 3 days. He been crucified. He went to hellfire. Can you imagine God going to hellfire? What kind? Huh? So now holy, we are not talking about anything. We are not going to stand there in front of the White House or the Red House. We want first establish something. We have something more important than talking about human being rights. We have to know about God's rights over you first. You see? So the first thing Nuh started with is what? He didn't say to you. No. قال قوم اعبدوا الله. اعبدوا الله واتقوه واطيعون. This is the first thing that you have to establish in your da'wah is the ibadah of Allah and who is Allah al-hayy, al-qayyum, لا تأخذه سنة ولا نوم, the living, self-subsistence, he doesn't sleep, no slumber take him, over his throne established, this what we need. Now you will know it's not a matter of calling him different name, you call him Jehovah, I call him Allah, you call it him God, no, it's a big difference. Is a big difference, and only there is one, and this is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, الذي لم يلد ولم يولد ولم يكن له كفوا أحد. Now a second step and a different approach, after he tried to remind them about the family relationship and the tribe relationship by saying, oh my people, and invite them to Allah, now he tried to give them targheeb, okay? Show them the excellence of being Muslims and accepted the da'wah. He tried to encourage them and show them the fruit of being Muslim. He said, يغفر لكم من ذنوبكم ويؤخركم إلى أجل مسمى إن أجل الله إذا جاء لا يؤخر لو كنتم تعلمون. He Allah will forgive you your sins and respite you to an appointment time. So now he tried to show them why you're supposed to be a Muslim. Okay? Allah will love you. Allah will forgive your sins. Allah will make blessing in your time. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bless you in this life and the hereafter. You be Abdullah. So now the da'iya need to do what? To give some targheeb and they try to show the people that he giving them da'wah, what is the excellence of Islam and what is the virtues of this religion. Now after he went on those the things that always the return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this was the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to always stand on prayer calling in Allah. قال ربي إني دعوت قومي ليلا ونهارا. Alright. Should I close? They start the salah already. He said, oh Allah, listen. Look how this Muslim, look this Prophet, he was so busy with his mission. Listen to this expression. قال ربي إني دعوت قومي ليلا ونهارا. Full time job. He want to get the PhD degree. Huh? He sweat. 16 hours. 6 hours in the university. And 4 hours making homework. And after this teaching for 3 hours. Some Muslims, they spend 16 hours a day because he want to get his PhD degree. This Nuh alayhi salam, the Prophet of Allah, Allah gave him a job. He won't fulfill the obligation. He said, قال ربي إني دعوت قومي ليلا ونهارا. This to teach us what? That we struggle very hard for the da'wah. ليلا, day and night. Day and night. That means every time he found a chance to approach them, doesn't matter if it's 2 o'clock, 3 o'clock, 5 o'clock in the morning, wherever it is, what time it is. And look, وإني كلما دعوتهم لتغفر لهم, every time I call them for Islam, so you forgive them, they do what? Now teaching us as a da'iyah that don't expecting things to be nice and smooth and they're going to get you some candy bars and some Pepsi and say welcome. No, it's going to be some hardship. Yesterday when I got mad on Brother Kamal, may Allah forgive me for what I did, astaghfirullah. I walk all here and I remember, I say, wow, why I'm getting upset? Look what the Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم happened to him. And after this, later on when he come to talk to me, I was cool. Why? I remember what happened to the Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. But in the beginning when I met Brother Kamal, he can tell you. He was about to understand, he saw the anger in my face that I was about to say, what is going on? I was upset for little small thing about the program and things like this. Don't expect everything to be fine. You go, you arrive in the airport and maybe nobody to receive you there, and you have to be standing there for half an hour. And after this, when somebody comes say, brother, you don't know I'm supposed to arrive 5 o'clock. As a da'iyah, prepare yourself. Huh? So here, Nuh is a prophet, and he said, oh Allah, every time I invite them, they do what? They stick their fingers and say, oh, please, come on, man. We don't want to hear it, huh? وَإِنِّي كُلَّمَا دَعَوْتُهُمْ لِتَغْفِرَ لَهُمْ جَعَلُوا أَصَابِعَهُمْ فِي آذَنِهِمْ وَاسْتَغْشَوْا ثِيَابَهُمْ وَأَصَرُوا وَاسْتَكْبَرُوا اسْتِكْبَارًا. He's the prophet of Allah. And here, this is the way how they deal with them. Putting fingers in the ears, cover their face, they don't want to see his face, they keep walking, and they insist about this kind of behavior. Did this stop Nuh alayhi salam? We need to study this surah. I want you, inshallah, for a homework when I come next year, tomorrow, not next year, that we're going to have some quiz about this. You need to go read the surah word by word, letter by letter. We learn da'wah from this Quran. وَأَصَرُّوا وَاسْتَكْبَرُوا اسْتِكْبَارًا ثُمَّ إِنِّي دَعَوْتُهُمْ جِهَارًا. But this didn't stop Nuh. He went again in public. Then this da'wah methodology didn't work in private, one-to-one basis, day and night. Now he went in public. He went in everywhere, in the street corner. He went in the public place. Where is their clubs? Where is it? Every place he approaches them, now his da'wah became for the general body and for everybody talking public. ثُمَّ إِنِّي أَعْلَنْتُ لَهُمْ وَأَسْرَرْتُ لَهُمْ إِسْرَارًا. Then verily I proclaim to them in public, and I have appealed to them in private. Subhanallah. So day and night. Okay? This is the time. Secret, private, and public. Okay? So he did not leave time or place or space, except he did what? He approached. And this is the da'iyah. Every time you find, you have to work. Your work is always there. You will find it. If you go on the bus, you go on the train, you walk in the street, you meet your family, you sit with your friends, you go inside the masjid, everywhere you found means for da'wah and a place for da'wah. Because we only think when somebody says Jesus Son of God, this is the only one you're going to give him da'wah. You found among the Muslims a lot of innovators. Do you give them da'wah? You found some Muslims, they don't know how to pray. This man, he came to the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam mosque, and up and down, see how many Muslims they do it like this today. He said, come on. Out. فصلي فإنك لم تصلي. Go back, make your salah over because you didn't make salah. You see? So the da'wah is not limited only to the kafirun. You're giving da'wah wherever you're going, and anytime you will find a place. If you're really sincere and serious to give da'wah, every time and every place you will find means and a place, somebody that you can talk to him. You have relatives. Like the sister yesterday, she asked, I don't go outside, my husband doesn't allow me this, that, how I can give down? I said to her, you have a telephone in your house. You have neighbors. I'm sure somebody come to visit you in your house. You have relatives who come to you. You don't have a telephone. Okay, you can write. There's different ways. Buy a booklet, take a pamphlet, anything, leaflet, and give it to them. Don't think that da'wah is limited only for men. وَالْمُؤْمِنُونَ وَالْمُؤْمِنَاتُ بَعْضُهُمْ أَوْلِيَاءُ بَعْضٍ يَأْمُرُونَ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَيَنْهَوْنَ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ وَيُؤْمِنُونَ بِاللَّهِ. The believers, male and female, are the protector of one another. They join the good and say forbid the bad. He did not say this job only for male. Huh? He didn't say only for male. فَقُلْتُ اسْتَغْفِرُوا رَبَّكُمْ إِنَّهُ كَانَ غَفَّارًا. Listen again. Here, after this, he will go again approaching with a different approach to try to show them the excellence of Islam and why. Because he talked to them about forgiveness before, alright? Forgiveness didn't work with them because they too far to understand about God to forgive them. So he gives them a different approach. He talked to them about the blessings of this life. Before he told them, فَقُلْتُ اسْتَغْفِرُوا رَبَّكُمْ إِنَّهُ كَانَ غَفَّارًا. okay? يغفر لكم من ذنوبكم. He told them about forgiveness. Didn't work with them, so now he coming also in a nice manner, but with a different approach. Now he's not going to tell them about paradise, he's going to talk to them about some of the worldly things. He said what? فَقُلْتُ اسْتَغْفِرُوا رَبَّكُمْ إِنَّهُ كَانَ غَفَّارًا يُرْسِلِ السَّمَاءَ عَلَيْكُمْ مِدْرَارًا وَيُمْدِدُكُمْ بِأَمْوَالٍ وَبَنِينَ ويجعل لكم جنات ويجعل لكم انهارا. You guys, you have a problem. All this homeless. Walk, you go to New York. See, where is it? See, by thousands. Look to them under the subway. No house for them. Look to some people, they have degrees. They license as a teacher. They could not find job. They selling perfume and incense on high street. Why? There is a problem with their economic. So now he comes to approach them with this approach. Say, oh my people, ask Allah's forgiveness. Repent to Allah. Because, and he will send rain to you in abundance. Because this is the main thing. If you have rain, you have what? You have cultivation. If you have cultivation, now you can harvest. You have fruit, you have vegetables, now you can sell, you can buy, you can make business, you can make money. وَيُمْدِدُكُمْ بِأَمْوَالٍ وَبَنِينَ وَيَجْعَلْ لَكُمْ جَنَّاتٍ وَيَجْعَلْ لَكُمْ أَنْهَارًا. And he also will supply you with money and children. All this is dependent on what? Accepting the da'wah. Turning away from the way of the shaitan to the way of Allah. Turning away from kufr to Islam. By turning away from jahiliyyah to Islam, this is what you get in this life. And he said, he give you financial assistance. And what? And he said, we give you what? Baneen, children. Why, akhi? It's very important. Baneen. It is very important. Because now when you have all this rain coming, all these fruits coming, all this money in your hand, and now you don't have any defense line, no army. You know, superpower going to start opening their eyes. Say, oh, look, look, there is some oil there. Huh? Not this oil that Brother Habib bought. No, the other oil. The oil that they're getting from down. Huh? Oh, they have some oil. Oh, look, they have this, they have that. So let's occupy this country. Let's take it. So now Allah will supply them as a result of accepting Islam, accepting Tawheed. He supplies them also with what? With the children. So you can have your own army. So you can protect what Allah has given you from blessings. So what was the approach here of Noah? He tried to show them the good in accepting Allah's way. And this is what we have to use when we give da'wah. It seems that this approach didn't work. It seems that this approach didn't work here, akhi. Is here, jazakallah khair. It seems this approach didn't work. So now this is the da'iyah always have to found. He have to have a different approach and always try not to give up, to be patient. So now, since this approach didn't work, listen what? ما لكم لا ترجون لله وقارا. What is the matter with you? That you fear not Allah. You don't fear His punishment. Why you don't honor Allah and respect Allah? And honor Allah in the proper manner. I'm telling you about Allah and about accepting Allah as your God. And you still, and I told you about all the things that is not working with you. وَقَدْ خَلَقَكُمْ أَطْوَارًا أَلَمْ تَرَوْا كَيْفَ خَلَقَ اللَّهُ سَبْعَ سَمَاوَاتٍ طِبَاقًا وَجَعَلَ الْقَمَرَ فِيهِنَّ نُورًا وَجَعَلَ الشَّمْسَ سِرَاجًا. Now he tried to open their mind more. Try to make them open their heart. Say, why you don't guard Allah and respect Allah? Look how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had created you in stages. From a drop of semen to a small piece of flesh, and after this, bones and all these stages, okay? And after this a baby, and after this a young man, and after this a strong man. So he tried to show them Allah's power, shows Allah's ability. So because this didn't work, now maybe this other approach will work. Look, reflect. You don't see how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had created 7 heaven, one above the other. And he made the qamar, as nur and light in it. And he made the sun, siraja. Wallahu anbatakum min al-ardi nabata. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brought you forth from the earth. Thumma yu'idukum fiha wa yukhrijukum ikhraja. Now he tried to remind them now about death, about hereafter, about how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created you from the earth, how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will cause you to die, and you will go again in the earth, how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala going to revive you, and he went in about reminding them about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Signs, it may be moved some of their feeling to accept Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala da'wah. In reality, I didn't start, this was my introduction for my lecture today. I didn't start, but I will take one paragraph and after this we go for this questions inshallah. And I pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make most of the questions for Abu Muslim and not for me. One thing what I was supposed to talk to you today about the methodology of da'wah, but what I gave today as Surah Nuh, and this was only introduction. And please my brothers and sisters, kindly go and reflect on Surah Nuh, as well as the whole Quran is follows da'wah and the methods of da'wah. But what I want to say today about the methodology of da'wah, for a successful da'wah, it depends on 4 things. And for you to imagine these 4 things, put yourself in the position of the doctor. And now the doctor have to examine the patient. He have to determine what kind of sickness he have, and after this he have to describe the proper medicine, and after this he have to make what you call it maybe another visitation to make sure that things is going. If you need a successful da'wah, you have to put yourself and always remember the doctor. So number one, you're going to be the doctor. You have to have the knowledge, okay? Don't jump into things, because if you don't have the knowledge, you maybe go to tell somebody about something haram is halal, and something halal you're telling him is haram, because you don't have the knowledge. And instead of teaching him about Allah and the unity of Allah, you may tell him, all of us worshiping God, and now he will take the word, and he believe what he's saying, and now he think, understand, he maybe even pray 5 times a day, and he still on the say Jesus God Savior and all these things. You see? So you have to have the proper knowledge to give the da'wah. And as I said yesterday, you don't have to be a scholar to give da'wah, because the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, بَلِّغُوا عَنِّي وَلَوْ آيَةً. Okay? Convey my message, even if in the shape of a verse. What I'm warning myself, inshallah, as well as you, that we don't jump to things that we are not capable to aid. So if you know about salah, now we can talk to somebody about salah. Don't try to jump and talk to them about jihad and polygamy and hippie and all the things, okay? So we did not say, don't give down. But we say, relate to things which you know it. Because the doctor have to study first, and they have to have the knowledge, and after this he's going to examine the person. Does he have a shubha? Does he have a bid'ah? Does he have a kufr? What is his situation? Okay? You don't, everybody come, he said to him, okay, roll your sleeve here. Give him a shot. All right? Maybe his eyes, and maybe his ear, and maybe his foot. You understand? You could not apply the same medicine. Somebody who's talking about innovation, somebody talking about Godship, somebody talking about, you have a doubt about the unseen, somebody. So you have to see where is the category you're going to put this person, so you can give him the proper medicine. Number 3, now you have to give the medicine in accordance with the sickness that he has. And after this, have to try to have some visitation, regular visitation with this person who already received this cure. Okay? Did he take it in the proper time? Did it work with him? Should he reduce the quantity or not? And what I mean by this, sometimes we give the da'wah. And sometimes the person took the shahada and he became a Muslim. And the second thing, takbir, Allah, takbir, Allah Akbar. And the next thing, the brother disappeared. Nobody called. Nobody, where is the brother that everybody was making takbir for? You understand? What's happening? So you could not, you understand, give the medicine and let him go, and this is it. You need to have a visitation, one after the other. Check on the brother, see if he making his salah, try to get him to the masjid. Do you need, you understand, somebody that you don't have a ride, your car broken down, we can come inshallah, brother so and so, he live closer to you, he can come, pick you, bring you to the masjid. This what is serious problem with people that we give them down in America. In many, many cases, the people, they come for the first month, a couple of weeks, disappear. Why? Because the doctor didn't give the right medicine, or he did not continue to carry his job towards this person. Inshallah, we still have one workshop more or two, it depends, okay? And we're going to be talking, to continue the subject about da'wah, inshallah, because I really hate to disturb some of you enjoying your nap. And if I keep talking, you understand, I know that you're going to go deeper and deeper. I mean, some of you, I'm not talking about all of you. So, plus we have a lot of questions. So, inshallah, I think the same time tomorrow, Brother Kamal?
Yes.
That we're going to continue about methodology of da'wah and other issues which are related to da'wah. And please forgive me for my long introduction. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it beneficial for all of us, inshallah, and Allah knows best. Would you mind reading it for me, inshallah? Enjoy my
The first question is, will there be a session with a sheikh addressing the sisters only? Well, as far as I know, we don't have anything planned like that as yet, but inshallah we'll try to see if something like that could be arranged. The second question is that, are the universities in Misr good for sisters?
Number one, the sister who's asking about university in Misr, in Egypt, is it good for, no. My understanding is that she means she want to go to study there. Is this correct?
Yes.
Number one, I will tell the sister, she have to fulfill her obligation towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for being a good Muslim. That means if you sister are not married, and you don't have a mahram to travel with you, you could not travel. Because alhamdulillah, the basic of understanding and learning this Islam had exist here in this place through scholars, learned people, videotapes, audio tapes, books, different ways. Therefore, for you to make a trip like this without a mahram, you shouldn't. Because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam forbid a woman to travel without a mahram. I'll be lying if I tell you good or bad, because I left, sure.
Okay, I can repeat. Well, the question is that, are the universities in Misr, Misr is Egypt, in Africa, good for sisters?
No, 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 akhi. Come on now, don't mix between Egypt and Africa. No. Africa is not in Egypt, akhi. So I say the sister could not travel without a mahram, and this is not a necessity for her to travel. If she have a mahram, this is something different. I left Egypt about approximately 25 years ago, so I don't know what is going on. But believe it or not, I don't advise anybody to go, because the seriousness of the matter, that we don't distinguish between what is a culture and what is Islam, and there's a lot of things there that you may be taught as Islam, or you see people practicing, you think is Islam, and is not, so you may be misled more than you be educated about Islam. This is my personal opinion, and anybody can agree or disagree with me, but this is my personal opinion. I don't advise for her to go to study there. She can get the proper information while she's here. And believe it or not, sometimes you can get pure and clean understanding Islam in your spot here more than going in a place like Egypt or other places. Allah, this is my personal opinion. It is a free country and I'm a free man, except for Allah.
If any brother has a question, they can come up to the mic and ask so that we can alternate between the questions from the brothers and the sisters. And maybe Brother Abu Muslima can also come in the front. So
yes,
that
please.
Sisters can go, spirit,
is this okay? The brothers, they don't mind, they like to be kind to their sisters. Let the sisters go first.
Okay, if you try to get a brother, sister to be better by example telling them to pray or calling when you are going to the mosque and they don't accept your information, do you still get the rewards?
Did you understand it?
Yeah,
I think.
I think basically what she's asking is that if you are giving dawah to Muslims, but they do not respond to your call, for example, if you are telling them to pray, but they do not pray, mm-hmm. do you get reward for okay. just inviting them?
Yes. You see, again, we have to remember that the job of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as well as all the da'iyah, فَذَكِّرْ إِنَّمَا أَنْتَ مُذَكِّرْ لَسْتَ عَلَيْهِمْ بِمُسَيْطِرْ. Remind, verily you are only a reminder, you have no authority over them. The guidance in the hand of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Our job as a da'iyah is to put the seed, that means to give the da'wah. For this seed to give a fruit or no, this is not your job. So you do the work, you get the blessings, inshallah. Now if this seed give fruit, now you get more blessings. Didn't get, inshallah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is still giving you blessing for your effort of giving da'wah.
Okay. The next question, another one from sisters is Sheikh Adli. Can you please describe the living conditions in your community, that is Islamic school for children and Islamic activities, things of that nature? If all of these are not established, do you know of any city in the United States where they are? Jazakallah khair, if these things do not exist in one area or if they are full of bidah, must we leave our area until we find Muslims doing such work?
I tell you a little bit about my community in very, very short, inshallah, and I hope this doesn't encourage you to come there. Although all Muslims are welcome, but sometimes we come with a lot of expectation, and perfection is only belong to Allah. So you may hear something and you think, oh, when I go there, I'm going to see good community, but you come and maybe something else, and so this brother deceived me. But anyway, alhamdulillah, by the will of Allah, we had established a school this year, full-time school. And we have it from kindergarten to 12th grade. And this was a big blessing that finally we pull our effort together and we took our children away from the kafirun, inshallah. The masjid is open every day for the five-time prayers, for classes, for Jum'ah. We have a sisterhood there. They have classes, they have their activities. We have a social gathering once a month. Different things here and there. We break iftar every night of Ramadan together. About 100-150 people get and break iftar with each other. Small minor things here and there. We inshallah hopefully looking forward soon that we establish some kind of a living community on a land. This program is under study, but inshallah we pray that Allah will bless us with it soon. That means we're thinking about buying a piece of land for those Muslims who like to live together, inshallah. We're going to try to provide this. But if anybody thinking about more, by the way, this is not only the community that have in this in the United States. I saw many, many other communities which alhamdulillah they have very good program, they have sisterhood there, they have a mosque, they have different activities, and even some of them they have social activity and things for helping others. So as a matter of, you can write to different communities inshallah and you can get to know about what kind of activities they have. But anybody is welcome to visit our community inshallah. It is in Columbia, South Carolina, and it's too far from here.
Jazakallah khair. Inshallah, there is a question and then there is a sister who probably wants there is a question related to divorce which she wants to be answered. So inshallah then we will come to that if you want. Because it's not related to the topic really. The question is, who is considered a mahram for sisters during traveling, for example on Hajj and otherwise?
Your mahram is your husband or a man whom you could not marry him under any condition, like your father, your brother, your uncle, your son, those called mahram, first degree relatives, if this is the term in English. A man whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it forbidden for you to marry him under any condition. Never ever you can marry him. And I give example by his son, your brother, your uncle, your father. If you are married, so your husband is your mahram.
Okay. Jazakallah khair. So, would you like to ask the question about
this? I can hear it.
Okay. Inshallah. Actually, it says that a Muslim sister who is divorced and about to remarry a Muslim brother, in brackets, has three children from previous marriage, I assume the brother. The previous husband wants the children. He has not provided maintenance for her, especially during and after the divorce. If she has kept track of this debt, can she hold or keep the children until this debt is paid full, in full?
So this has nothing to do with the divorce. This have related to hadana or custody. How old the kids, it depend also how old is the kids. You see the hadana or the custody for little kids, you understand, that who under like 6-7 years old. After while this period between when he's a baby until 6-7 years old, some they said about maybe 9. During this period, the mother has the right over them as long as she don't remarry. Now, if she remarry, if there is any Muslim relatives in her side, they will have the right before the father taking them. Okay, if she remarry, that means if her sister, as example, the aunt of the kids, she Muslim, she will take the custody of her mother or anything like this. If not, the custody will go to the father or his mother or anything like this. But if the child reach age that he or she can take care of all their own personal things like washing, dressing themselves, eating, so in this time it's no custody for mother or a father. The child has the right to choose whom he want to go to the father or to the mother.
Okay.
I hope this is clear, inshallah.
Jazakallah khair.
And Allah knows best.
Oh. Please. What about the child support? Okay. Let me repeat it.
Okay, this amount of money still a debt on his side, but this doesn't mean prevent him from having the custody of the children. And as I said, the custody of our children is only to a certain age. So if this kid is above that age, or they mix, okay, this is a different story also, but he obligated to support his kids, not her. She has no support after her idda finish, no support for her, but the support is for the kids. So now if I say he didn't support the kid, it's still a debt in his side. But still, this is not for her to prevent him to take the kids if there is no Muslim in her side to take the custody, or if the kid is still younger than the age that they can take care of their own personal things.
Okay.
Clear? Allah knows best.
Jazakallah khair. It says, Sheikh Adli, if you and your husband are having problems...
Excuse me?
I'm just reading the question.
Yes, okay, all right, no problem. I understand, but I'm only trying to wake you up, brothers. Okay. Thank you, sister, for waking the brothers. Okay.
Okay, if you and your husband are having problems...
You have to be careful, you live in America, your brother, this is crazy.
Okay, so I won't read this phrase again. Should your husband give up and leave?
Again.
Okay, if you and your husband are having problems, mm-hmm. Should your husband give up and leave? I think the rest of the question explains. I asked him to go with me and... I don't see. And see, I think to see a counselor to try and make our marriage work. He has not given me a response. What should I do? He is not fulfilling his duties as a Muslim husband now that he is away from home. He just comes and goes as he pleases.
Okay. I will advise the sister, inshallah, that she try to see how she can get to talk to him by different means. And I'm sure sisters or female in general, they have their own tactics and their own ways how they can get to a man to do something, or at least to listen or to talk to him if they want. So I will advise her to find whatever feminine tactics to approach him until he can sit down, at least talk to him. She maybe can, I don't want to have to go in details, but one of the things that you can make him a nice cake as example, and have a nice maida for him when he come, and when he sit down to eat, he can try to go and rub his shoulder, you understand, and take his kufi and hang it there and be nice to him, and after this we think we can talk now. Or the other stuff. And if all the things he try your best didn't work, now you can try to see the imam in the community. If you think this will bring about a serious problem more, maybe you can find a close brother, okay, somebody who's buddy-buddy, and you can talk to him that what about you talk to your friend, you understand, and see if you can try to work about this problem. So even if he talk and walk away and kept walking and all the things, you should, inshallah, don't give up hope, and you try to see a different way that you can get him to consultation, or inshallah you can try to write him. And some people sometimes think I'm crazy, a woman going to write to her husband, but believe it or not, okay, sometimes he's not ready to listen from you, but you write a letter and leave it there beside this nice meal that you cook for him and go sleep, all right, and make it visible there so he can see it. And curiosity with most of us, he will open it, you understand, especially if you put some kind of decoration on the letter, or he will try to read it, and he don't have anybody in front of him to argue with. So now we catch him in a chance that he could not argue. He's going to go through the whole thing. Okay? So let's try to talk, let's try to work it, you understand. I'm willing to do whatever you want, but at least let's talk. And to try to give up, inshallah, some of your what you call brides. So you can, inshallah, humble yourself.